So last week we actually had the big map out and prayed over the map for the persecuted church. And wasn't that amazing? Anybody appreciate that? Was it good? I love that that day when we do that every year, and it is such a great reminder, but it's also an amazing time when you actually get to see the nations that you're praying for, see the map. But, you know, we prayed for our brothers and sisters around the world that are in the persecuted church in North Korea and Laos and China and Nigeria and other parts of the world. We watched some videos. We watched some emotional videos of people that have experienced incredible loss as a result of persecution, as a result of naming the name of Jesus. They've lost everything. Many of them had lost loved ones that were murdered right in front of them. And how did we respond? How did we respond? And to be honest, for most of us, if we're truly honest, you know, we went home and we picked up some food on the way, or we had some food at home, and, you know, some people then relaxed into the recliner and put on the pacifier of football and just kind of disengaged our minds from what we had just experienced and just seen and just heard. You know, I think sometimes our Western church mindset is desensitized towards horrific news, because we see horrific news on the TV and then we just either change channels, or we see an announcement or a commercial, and it's just like the switch is flipped, and, well, it doesn't really trouble us anymore. And how do we actually engage with the suffering and hurt of our brothers and sisters around the world? How do we engage with that and truly relate to that? And, you know, honestly, some of us don't relate to that because we really feel, well, that couldn't happen here. That could never happen here. That's over there. Could never really happen here. But suffering takes on many different forms, and that could happen here. History has shown that no country is immune from persecution. Christians have been persecuted for thousands of years. But suffering also takes on many different forms. Persecution is but one aspect of suffering. We also have illness, financial hardship, relational hardships, different things that cause us to suffer, things that cause pain in our lives. And we all face suffering in our lives at one point or another. We all face hardship and suffering. And that's been the theme as we've been looking through 1 Peter. The letter that Peter wrote to the early church, the Apostle Peter wrote to the early church in Asia Minor, and the theme throughout has been writing to the persecuted church, but he was actually saying, it's tough now, but it's going to get worse. There's more persecution coming. But the theme is a Christian's hope in times of trial. A Christian's hope in times of trial. We've looked at that we as followers of Jesus are not without hope in times of trial. And today we come to the end of the book, and it's actually been 18 weeks. If you hadn't noticed, we've actually, because we stopped during the summer, and so it's kind of been going backwards and forwards, and it's been 18 weeks looking at the same graphic. You've been very patient. But I don't know about you, but it's spoken to me personally. To me personally and our family, it's been a year of suffering. It's been a hard year. It's been a year that the Lord has allowed us to meditate on what He is saying as I'm preaching it. And it's been challenging. And Peter touches on, in this little summary that he does in the end of chapter 5 of 1 Peter, he kind of sums up everything he's been saying in the whole letter. And we're going to look at that today. But if you're suffering today, if you're encountering pain, hardship, illness, different kinds of suffering today, the message today is suffering leading to glory. Suffering that leads to glory. And that's God's purpose. There's no suffering that's wasted. There's no purposeless suffering. It leads to glory. And it might be hard for you to hope in glory when you're going through the suffering. It might be extremely hard when that suffering doesn't seem to go away. There doesn't seem to be any end to the pain, the hardship that you're going through. So how do we respond when the pain doesn't lift? How do we respond when the suffering doesn't go away? And it doesn't look like it's going to go away anytime soon. I'm here to tell you that there is hope. There is hope. There's hope in the gospel. Jesus has given us promises that we can hold on to in times of trial. There's glory coming. So let's turn to God's word. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5 to 15. So beginning in verse 5 of 1 Peter 5. Likewise, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you. Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kind of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. By Silvanus, a faithful friend, brother, as I regard him, I have written briefly to you, exhorting and declaring that this is the true grace of God. Stand firm in it. She who is at Babylon, who is likewise chosen, sends you greetings, and so does Mark, my son. Greet one another with a kiss of love. Peace to all of you who are in Christ. Amen. When I was in school many years ago, in high school in South Africa and throughout our school, I hated this time of the year. This time of the year was a time of suffering. The reason being is our school calendar went from January to December. And so we had our summer break in December because it's Southern Hemisphere. But so the school year was literally mid to end of January to the beginning of December. And the way the school system was set up was that you wrote final exams in November and December. And the final exams counted for everything. So throughout the year, you got no grades for homework, you got no grades for assignments. Nothing counted except the final exam. So you could literally coast through the whole year and do no work and just show up for the final exam, which is what I would do. And so the final exam was very stressful. It was a time of suffering. I had to lay aside all the things that I'd been doing and wasting time with, doing minimum of work. And then suddenly at the end of the year, all the pressure was on because those exams counted whether or not you were advanced to the next grade. The exams counted whether or not you got a scholarship to college. They counted whether or not you got into college. Everything was on one test, one exam. So it was a time of suffering. But in that suffering, we had parents, we had teachers that encouraged us, that helped us through the trial, that gave us wisdom and helped us through preparing us for the trial, the testing. And the Apostle Peter knew that the church was about to go into a time of testing, about to go into a time of trial, and he was preparing them for that fiery trial of persecution. And God was speaking through Peter this whole letter to the church to say, get ready, you're about to go through some trials, some suffering. Be prepared. And he wanted the church to be prepared. And he closed his letter with three important instructions that the church should follow, three important instructions that would help them go through the suffering they were about to experience. And if they were to glorify God through the difficult experience, these three things they needed to do. The first one was to be humble. To be humble. Verse 5, likewise, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. In the letter, Peter already given instructions to the church to submit to one another. He said, submit to the governing authorities. Submit to one another in your workplaces, to your bosses. Submit to your leadership. And in chapter 3, he says, wives, submit to your husbands, which we looked at. If you want to go back and look at that sermon at 1st September, we looked at that. Because I know some people don't like those texts, but we're encouraged to submit to one another. And now he addresses the young people to submit to the elders. And in the context of this scripture, in the context of the Greek here, it's actually not the elders or pastors, shepherds of the church. It's actually the older generation. It's respecting and submitting to the wisdom and the leadership of those who are older, who've kind of done the journey longer than we have. I think that's something that's kind of lost in our generation today, that honor and that respect for those that have gone before us. Those elders on really on whose shoulders we stand. You know, this building that we get to worship in every Sunday was built by people, many of whom are no longer with us, but we're to honor them. Their vision that they had for the church here at Grace Point. We're standing on their shoulders. And a healthy church honors the voice of all generations. It's important. And in fact, next week we're going to be doing a bit of that during the service, the second service next week, as we honor a couple in our church family. But the key is humility. Submission requires humility. Verse 6, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you. We're humbly to submit to one another, to submit to preferring one another. That's what submission is. It's simply being humble and preferring one another. And we are to submit to God and his authority. When we get that submission to God right, submitting to one another is easy. When we understand who we are in Christ and we submit to our Heavenly Father, we can then easily submit to one another. Peter writes that we are to clothe ourselves in humility. And we looked at this a couple of weeks ago. I think when Peter was writing this, he was remembering how Jesus clothed himself in humility. And the beautiful picture that we have is in Matthew 7, where Jesus washed his disciples' feet. He actually took off his garments to wash his disciples' feet by clothing himself in humility. But we have the picture of that Paul wrote to the church in Philippi, in Philippians chapter 2, where he says in verse 6 to 8, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. I believe, and it certainly is the case, that pride is the root of all sin. Pride is the foundation of sin. It caused Satan to fall, Adam and Eve to fall in their sin. And if pride is the root of all sin, humility is the most powerful weapon we have as the church. It's the exact opposite. It's the most powerful thing that we have as a church is to be humble and serve one another. There's incredible power in humility. But humility is not demeaning ourselves and thinking poorly of ourselves. That's false humility. That's, in fact, cloaked in pride. No, humility is really thinking less of ourselves and thinking highly of other people. We pray for revival. We want to see God move in power. But the key to revival is humility. As we are humbled before the Lord, as we humble ourselves before Him and are preferring one another, we will see revival break out. The phrase in verse 6, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God. It's an interesting phrase. Under the mighty hand of God. It can be interpreted different ways, but I believe one of those ways is that when God wants to do a powerful work in our lives that brings glory to Him, sometimes we feel God's mighty hand. Sometimes we feel His heavy hand on us. God allows us to feel the heavy weight of suffering. That's a natural humbling. You know that suffering people are seldom prideful. Suffering people seldom have time for pride. But the glorious hope that we have is the promise of the rest of that verse. Verse 6, humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time He may exalt you. The key, of course, is at the proper time. We don't know the proper time, but God never exalts us before the proper time, before we're ready for it. First, there has to be the cross before there's the crown. First, there has to be the suffering, and then there's the glory. Moses was under the mighty hand of God for 40 years in the wilderness as God prepared him to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt. Possibly, we don't know the exact timeline, but Joseph was submitted under the heavy hand of the Pharaoh in Egypt and the being imprisoned and so on before. It's about 13 years that Joseph suffered before he's exalted to the palace in Egypt. So the hardest part of suffering is learning patience. The hardest part of suffering is learning patience and endurance. Because, you know, sometimes if we think about it really, impatience is a remnant of pride. It's a remnant of pride because, like, I don't deserve this. I shouldn't be doing this. But God is working that out through suffering. But God doesn't simply put us under His heavy hand like some cruel taskmaster. He doesn't simply put His weight on us so that we can suffer without purpose. He gives us a promise in verse 7, casting all your anxieties on Him because He cares for you. This is a promise in God's Word. That begins with humbling ourselves. Giving God our anxieties must come from the reality is, I cannot handle this. I'm going to cast it on You, Lord. I'm going to give it to You, Lord, because I cannot handle this. I think men struggle with this the most because we're taught to deal with your problems. Handle your problems. Be strong. Don't show weakness. Don't ask for help. Especially if you just opened a box from IKEA. Don't read the instructions. That's not what men do, right? No. We got to cast our burdens on the Lord, our struggles onto Him. And that begins by us humbling ourselves, giving God our anxieties. But you know, God cannot take our worries and our anxieties. We must hand them over to Him in humility. The word anxiety is actually translated as being torn apart. There's a picture of actually ourselves being torn apart. That's what anxiety does to you. It rips you apart. And holding on to anxiety is at its core prideful. And the heavy hand of God lovingly gets heavier as we hold on to our anxieties, causing us to say, I release them to You because He cares for you. God cares for you. I think sometimes we struggle to really believe that when we're going through suffering. We don't trust that He's good. That's a lie from Satan. So how do we do this? How do we cast our anxieties on the Lord? Sounds very biblical, sounds very good, but how do you physically do that? So this week I was in the prayer room in our tent of meeting, actually on Thursday, and preparing and praying through this, and I was weighed down by a lot of anxieties, just weighed down by a lot of burdens. And I was like, Lord, I cast them on you, Lord. I give them to you, Lord. Didn't feel like anything shifted. And I prayed harder, Lord, I give this to you. I didn't feel like any, it's just like, I still have this burden I'm carrying, and it didn't feel like it was getting any lighter. And so what I did was, again, this is not prescriptive, this is just what the Lord showed me to do. I began writing them all out. I just took a piece of paper and began writing out the things that were weighing me down, the things that were burdening me, the anxieties that were tearing me apart. And I began writing them out one by one. And I don't know if you've been in the prayer room, we have a shredder. And so I took that and I just put it in the shredder and just allowed it to be shredded up. And it was in that moment that I felt the Lord taking those burdens from me. I actually did something practical that physically did something to cast my burdens on the Lord. Now, for each of us, that may be something very different. It may be writing it out. It may be burning that piece of paper. It may be simply going for a walk and speaking out your anxieties to the Lord. Taking a long walk where you can yell at the trees in the sky when no one else is around and just cast your burdens on the Lord. But we actually have to do some things in the physical for God to manifest his power in the spiritual. And that's just an example of how God showed me. But God shows his love and his care for us when we give our cares to him, when we release them to him. And I believe that he performs four ministries on our behalf, four promises from the Word of God that he does when we cast our cares on him. And there's four scriptures. I'm going to go through them very quickly if you want to write them down. But the first one is, he gives us the courage to face our cares honestly and not run away from them. Isaiah 41:10, fear not, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. He gives us the courage to face it. Secondly, he gives us wisdom to understand the situation. Wisdom to understand what we're going through. We don't have the answers, but sometimes we can see God's perspective in that. James 1:5, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given to him. Thirdly, he gives us the strength to do what we must do. Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. That's not just a verse for NFL quarterbacks to put on their arms. No, that's for all of us. When we're weak, he is strong. And he gives us the strength to do what he calls us to do. The fourth one is, he gives us the faith to trust him. He gives us the faith to trust him to do the rest, to do the impossible that we cannot do. Psalm 37, verse 5, commit your way to the Lord, trust in him, and he will act. These are four promises from God's word when you cast your burdens on him. I could spend all day just looking at those four verses, but the bottom line is it takes humility to give your cares to the Lord, to hand your burdens over, and then leave them there. Our pride tempts us to go and pick them up and carry on trying to fix them, but to leave them at the feet of the cross, the foot of the cross. The second instruction that Peter gives to the church is to be watchful. Verse 8, he says, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Several weeks ago, Christy had a tire in her car that just kept going flat. It would constantly go flat. It was a slow leak. You know, it would take a few days, and you just notice the pressure's going down, and it's so annoying because it's not a complete flat, but it's just slowly leaking out, and it was really annoying because I had to tell her every 3 days, put air in your tire, put air in your tire. But it was a constant burden. It was a drain. And finally, one day, I said, I'm going to fix this thing. Took the tire off, found out there was a large screw in the tire, pulled it out, plugged the thing, patched it, put it back on, and it's fixed. But sometimes we battle through suffering, and we just carry on with that burden. We carry on, oh, I know every 3 days I'm going to have to deal with this. Our pride says, You can hang on. You can do it. When God is calling us to let it go, to release it to Him. But we, in our weakness and in our pride, we simply dig deeper and say, I can keep doing this. I can keep maintaining it. But there's always a root cause, like that screw in the tire. There's always a root cause that's causing us the pain. We have an enemy who comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. That's his agenda. Peter writes, be sober-minded. In other words, think rightly about the situation. Look at the situation and be sober-minded. Think about it the right way. Think about it God's way. Not in our human reasoning, but allow Him to give us the wisdom. This is hard when we're suffering, but it's absolutely crucial to have a right thinking, to have God's perspective, to know His promises for that situation, the promises of His Word, the eternal promises of God. Now, we must note that not every problem we have in life is Satan attacking us. You know, sometimes it's our own stupidity. The things that we've done, the stupid things that we do, we can acknowledge that, but we do have an enemy who seeks to kill and destroy. He's the enemy of our souls. Even though he was defeated on the cross, for a time he still has power. And he's very active and very destructive. We make a mistake by not being watchful. Peter says he is a roaring lion. Prior to being in ministry, I was a mechanical engineer, and I love to design things, I love to build things, I love to see things that were in the mind become real machines and things. I love that, but I am not an electrical engineer, and because I don't like electricity, it bites. I can't see it, and it bites me. So, you know, hats off to the electrical engineers in our midst. But what an electrical engineer or an electrician will tell you is electricity, if you respect it, you can handle it, but you have to respect it. And I believe it's the same way with Satan. He is a defeated power, but we have to respect his power because he's dangerous. And sometimes we tend to dismiss the fact that Satan does have power to hurt, to steal, to kill. Within God's parameters. He is a formidable enemy, and we need to respect that, not to give him authority, not to give him undue power and glory, no. But if we understand that Satan uses tools like discouragement, hopelessness, pridefulness, arrogance, these are some of the tools that Satan uses when we're not thinking sober-mindedly. Whatever God designs for good, Satan comes and creates a counterfeit. We can see that in all the world around us. When you look at something that's evil, it's a counterfeit of something that God has done that's good. And the fruit of Satan's counterfeit is always death. It always leads to death. That's what Satan does. We need to be watchful. We need to be sober-minded. One of Satan's most effective tools is twisting the scriptures. Twisting the word of God. Way back in Genesis 3, he said, did God really say? And he still uses the word of God today to deceive people. This is why we need to be people of the word. We need to know the word of God, need to memorize the word of God. Psalm 119, 105 says, I have stored up your word in my heart that I may not sin against you. Do we meditate on the word of God? Do we store it up in our hearts so that when the enemy comes and attacks, we know what the sword of the Spirit says in relation to that temptation? We're to be watchful. And at the same time, to resist the enemy. Verse 9, resist him firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. Stand firm on the promises of God's word. We can stand firm on the promises of God's word. Ephesians 6, Paul writes about spiritual warfare and the fact that we have enemies of principalities and power and powers and demons and evil forces. And what does he tell us to do? Ephesians 6, 10 and 11, it says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. It means that we take our stand on the foundation of the Word of God. If we don't know the Word of God, we've got nothing to stand on. We need to know the Word of God. Satan often gets us involved in a battle that's already been won because we don't know the Word of God, or we don't believe the Word of God. Peter reminds his readers that you're not alone in this. Believers all around the world are suffering the same kind of pain that you're going through. As we saw last week, the world has believers just like us, but wrestling very, very difficult situations. Let's resist the temptation to isolate and say, well, this is my problem, and I'm just going to go and fix it by myself on my own, and then I'll come back. No, that's a lie again from the enemy. He's a roaring lion. If you know anything about lions, lions will, when they attack a herd of antelope, they will look for the one that's isolated, the one that's weak, the one that's off to the side. And they will isolate that one even further and then attack it. If you stay in the herd, the lion has less power to attack. Not that we're a herd, but we're the body of Christ. To stay together in family, in community, in the body, it's our protection. We can call on each other for prayer, call on each other for when we're going through difficult times, when we're suffering. That's the purpose of the body of Christ. And then thirdly, and finally, Peter says, be hopeful. Be hopeful. This is what we want to hear when you're going through suffering. Verse 10 and 11, and after you have suffered a little while, the God of grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Peter ends this letter with a powerful, glorious truth. No matter how difficult the trial, no matter how challenging the situation, there is always hope in a certain victory. When you've suffered a little while, he says. For some, it seems like they've been suffering all their lives, right? What's a little while? You know, we have to see our days in light of eternity. We have to see this life in light of eternity. Paul had this same thought in mind when he wrote to the Corinthian church in 2 Corinthians 4:17, for this light and momentary affliction. Now, Paul wrote that he was a man that suffered much. And he says it's light and momentary, it's just a moment, is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. For many of you, it doesn't feel light. It doesn't feel momentary, does it? So does God lie? Does his word lie to us? No, God doesn't lie. God sees all of eternity. He sees an eternal perspective of everything that we're going through in our lives. And one day we'll have that same perspective. We'll be able to see all things in the light of eternity. This is no less painful, what we're going through, but it is passing. And it will lead to glory. Romans 8:18. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory which will be revealed in us. One day when we get to see everything in the light of glory, in our glorified bodies, we'll say, that was nothing in light of the glory that God has in store for us. And I also believe that we must not give up hope in the glory in this present age, in this present life that we lead. When we're going through an extended season of suffering, there is glory and hope in this life and the next. God is still a God of miracles. He is still a God that works wonders in our lives. Our Heavenly Father is incredibly invested in developing character in us. He's incredibly invested in creating Christ in us. He's intent on preparing the church as a bride for Christ. That's what he's doing. He's refining the bride. He's refining the church. He's equipping us. And God uses various methods of preparing the church, refining his bride. God uses that in many different ways. Discipleship through studying the Word of God together, meditating on the Word. But sometimes the refining fire is a trial. It's painful. And Peter uses four words to underline the promise of God to his children. I love this part of the whole book could be summed up in this one final thing, because he loves to restore, to confirm, to strengthen and establish his children. He restores his children. God promises to restore you after suffering. But he doesn't take you back to the way you once were. You know, sometimes when we're suffering, we say, I just want to go back to the way it was before this pain and suffering. God says, no, I'm going to restore you to your original design. I'm going to restore you better than you were before. I've taken you through the suffering, and what you will be is better than what it was. He's going to restore you to his design for you, his perfect plan for you. The Greek translation is actually to cause to be fully qualified. To restore means to be fully qualified. Gives a sense of, I'm now ready, you are now ready for future ministry. Prepared to serve the Lord completely. And then he says, confirm, to fix firmly, to set fast. The believer who is set fast, confirmed in the Lord, will not be moved by persecution or led away to false doctrine. Then he says, strengthen. Strengthening just means that. God will strengthen you to meet the demands of life, the challenges that you're going through. What good is it to stand on a firm foundation if we don't have the power to live it out? He will give the strength to live it out. And then to establish. The word literally means to lay a foundation, a firm, solid foundation. As Jesus said, the house that's built on the rock will stand firm. That's to establish. A believer who is equipped by God, continue in the faith, grounded and settled. Paul writes in Ephesians 4, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. You'll be established, grounded, restored. He will restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish his children. That is God's promise to us. And as we wrap up this entire book and look at it, that's what he promises to do through suffering. We have hope in times of suffering. And maybe today you're suffering. And I'm losing my voice. Maybe today you're suffering. And you don't see the why behind it. Seldom does God say, oh, I'm going to allow you to go through this, and this is why I'm doing this. We seldom see that. It may feel at times that God has forgotten you, or he's even angry at you. Let me assure you today, by the promises of God's word and the testimony of millions that have gone before us, because we do have that testimony of those that have gone before us, there is hope in glory. Not only in the eternal glory, but wholeness, restoration, healing now that God is able to give you in this life. So as we close, if God's been speaking to you today and you would require or like some prayer, our ministry team will be up here at the end as the worship team comes forward as I close in prayer. And I just want to offer you the opportunity today, if you'd like someone to pray with you, as God has been speaking to us through 1 Peter, just come up and share with one of our ministry team and let them pray for you. But I'll pray as the ministry team, as the worship team and ministry team comes forward, and let's pray together. Lord, thank you for the promises of your word. Thank you, Lord, for these rich promises that are true. Lord, I pray that you would forgive us of our pride, our self-sufficiency, It's so easy that our self-sufficiency can become an idol. We pray, Lord, that you'd forgive us of this. Help us to stand firm. To stand firm when the storms of life and the lies of doubt are sown in our thoughts, Lord. Help us by your Spirit to stand firm in your truth. Lord, I pray that you would bless us to love your word, to meditate on your word, to feed on your word. And that your name would be glorified in our lives. And Lord, as the letter closed, to your name be dominion forever and ever. Amen.